Yes. But it's actually really Peter with his son really convinced me for the first time in a long time to go into to make a holiday in a country which is not a wine region available. But let's go back to the topic of the task here now. My wonder after Arthur now had lots of do about the bowels of tech, what to do about how to convince tech to handle different languages in hibernation and these kinds of stuff. I'm now targeting a different part of the authoring environment that we have, namely the index creation. To create a register in a book or whatever else, something to have which is all you know, and most of you probably think it's quite easy. You just have to collect some kinds of terms, then you have to put some page numbers behind them, to sort them a bit, and that's all you need, don't you?
Yes. Yes.
Well, I thought so as well, and we have to make index for that. That's sufficient, isn't it? So why do we want to have another different system? Okay, in my talk here about is why do we want to have another system? Actually, the system was first presented to the tech community 10 years ago at the Eurotech 98 presentation. And I now would like to keep it up, to take it up again. This is a revisited part of things, to tell you, to those of you who don't know Xindi, what is Xindi, what does it do for you, and what is available now. Xindi itself is an index processor, just like MacIndex. The special thing is that you get lots of multilingual support out of the box. Nothing to do except just naming what kind of language would you have. So we have out of the box currently 44 languages supported. And I have to say, we can label it, some of them are there in variants. Overall, we have 53 different, ready to use without any part of special thing that you have to do in any configuration, just name them. And you can just use them out of the box. For those of you who are English speaking, this might not be an improvement for against MacIndex. But perhaps some of you create indexes for different things than pure English. Another advantage that we have compared to MacIndex is that we support several encodings. First of all, UTF-8, which means that for the modern, as Arthur called them, well, if you look at Aleph and Omega, maybe not so modern, but if you look at but if you look at the current crop of tech engines, it is possible to work to enhance the authoring environment for them as well. Because currently, you often have a problem if you use, for example, CTEC, that you might be able to have some document in UTF-8. But how do you create the index afterwards without something that does that cross UTF-8 afterwards? We also have something which is called markup normalization. I can later do it. And we support all kinds of things. What I want to skip in this talk, but mention nevertheless, you all have to tout your system that you are about. You come later. I don't want that myself interrupted by you. I learned my lesson well over the last year, John.
No, it's negative. It's a point of, query. You talked the previous thing about encodings. Are you talking character sets or character encodings?
I talked about character encodings, actually.
So the bit sequences.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I will not really go into deep, but what I want to mention here is if you create an index, most of you have just page numbers. If somebody of you want to create an index for something different, for example, for Bible, where you have book names in them, which are enumerated, or for music pieces, which have names in them, that, which means your location, which you reference, are more than just page numbers, or if they are highly structured. If they have something which is not just some sequence of numbers, but collections, first a book number, then an arbitrary letter, then some numbers, and so on. And you know, want to know how to handle this and create ranges over the structure things as well. Then Xindi is something for you. Because this is our possibilities that we have in the system. And this is actually needs a bit more work than just naming things. Here you have to create some kind of configuration, and there's a declarative style language to say to tell Xindi what kind of location structures you have, what kind of locations you have. Right? This style language is also used to create the to configure the output markup. So we have one style language which just say, okay, very similar to the things that MakeIndex does. Well, perhaps big different because you will receive styles that work. So if you look currently, for example, in TechLive and look all of these MakeIndex styles, you will perhaps, if you really look in them, see that there are lots of clauses there that MakeIndex don't support at all. And then you might recognize that my name is in them. That was okay. Oh yeah, and actually one of the most important contributions that I think we made is that we created a theoretical model of index creation. And I'm also in contact with people from the EX Tech. And if these guys who are currently talking about over there, I mean Taco and Hans, yes, if you ever plan to implement something new in Lua, I would say the theoretical model behind SIMDI might be the most lasting contribution. Even if the tool itself disappears, is supplanted by something else, reflection of the analysis, what is an index and what must be done to produce an index, I think is something that we should retain. So let me go into the talk itself and what's going on here. Well, languages that we use, which means if anybody wants to produce an autobiography of Lieutenant Worf from Star Trek, it's possible to do so because we even have Klingon. But if yes, and here you can see why we need why UTF-8 is not sufficient, because sometimes you need different encodings as well. And but if you look at them more closely, you will recognize that it's actually not some really wide selection. We have a strong focus on European languages, and that's quite frankly something because it's a community effort. And people from languages from the Asian part of the world, African, also Middle East. We only had some people from Israel who came and who supported us. Is something which didn't well appear in our community up to now, and so we were not able to create something that you can use out of the box. Actually, we have this guy, Yves Corbet, currently contacting us to support Sanskrit, and I hope that we will get to be able to make something together. And what you do as if you create your index is you just tell Xindi when you call it, I want to have this language. Well, almost what you have to do. Because sometimes, oops, it doesn't go forward. Sometimes telling them a language is not sufficient. Because there are index sorting or index creation. It's not simply sorting some letters around. There are lots of cultural peculiarities to be obeyed, to be looked at if you create an index. Let's take my mother tongue, German. We actually don't have one sorting, one index creation thing. We have two of them. And the two of them is one for us and one for you guys. Well, for you non-German guys. So, but we have these umlaut characters, A, the stuff, A, Ö, Ü. And these umlauts are actual real characters. They are national characters, and if we in domestic books, or if the book is made for domestic market, we sort them, the A, like an AE, or like an OE, or like an UE. And this is what we call DIN sorting. DIN is our German standards organization. Because that's the way it's done for German. But it would not be a good thing for in phone books or in some kind of dictionaries or anything that is probably be read by foreigners, because they wouldn't know that if they have this funny looking A with the two dots on it, that they would need to look it up under AE. It wouldn't be this. So for books that will be produced or publications that we will produce for the international market, we simply treat them as normal letters with accents on them. So what's actually happening here is that you have to tell Cindy, I want to have German with DIN sorting or German with Duden sorting. And then both of them is available, of course, but it is something that we can't decide in advance. If you have an authoring environment that just says this is German, this might be sufficient for many typesetting things, but it's not sufficient for indexing. Because of indexing, you have to have even more precise configuration there. And there's also some different stuff, like in Greek, you have polytonic Greek and other. We have these nice French people. And I always think, well, I always have two concerns. First, they do this just to make it more complex and more difficult, so that the cultural complexity doesn't suffer. The second is, what I present you now, I would like to know if there's any other example actually for this done. So if you have these four words here, to, I think they even pronounce rather differently, not pate. But
Cote,
agree. my French is not good enough. But if you sort them, that's first you start sorting quite normally. You sort from left to right, just like the arrow goes. The C is, and you ignore all the X's. So these four words are sorted the same. And then you have to sort, in the end, you still have to bring in an order, because that's what sorting is about. Sorting means that you have some characters there, languages, which are made up of alphabets, which means some kind of pieces of a word, and you sort according to those pieces. And then you order them pieces. And we usually think about sorting from left to right, or from right to left, if there's another scripting system which goes from left to right. No, that's not sufficient, because sometimes you sort first the one and then the other direction. In French, for example, where everybody thinks that French is quite a normal system, but what has happened is that if everything sorts the same, then you sort from the back to the start, and first put the letters without the accents, and then the letters with the accent. What this means here is that this is placed first because the E has no accent, and you look at the back first of the letter, and otherwise this word would come first, because here we have the O over there. So yeah, what we have here are, I call them legacy rules, which one should obey in a system that creates proper indexes for different languages. I just said that indexing or index sorting, when an index means to have some alphabet, to have some characters, and a word is made up of characters, and that you just reduce sorting of whole words to sorting over those alphabets that you then combine. As I just said, combination is not as simple as going from left to right or right to left. You might have some juggling around, but in the end it boils down that sorting words means sorting characters at first. But then we come to the point, what is a character? And that's actually not so easy to practice. Because you have, for example, in Spanish, letters like LL or CH, which are actually one letter. And if we all would have Unicode systems, this might be not a problem, because Unicode LL is an own character in its own right. So there is probably to be in some far, far away future an editor which really gives us this LL character, and we know this is a character LL. But up till now, people use their normal system and they type two times an L on their keyboard. And so what we have to do then is to have a more complex character recognition. This is arguably less a problem for non-Latin scripts, because they very often don't have the legacy of the ASCII code and the way something is represented on a computer. And so they have more kinds of markup or direct Unicode support in their editing systems, so they have this distinct representation of some character. Well, perhaps, and not to speak of languages like Khmer or so on, where a character is a rather complex element with lots of sub-character parts around them, which also contribute into sorting them. And that's just European languages. In Asian language, we have phonetic sorting. We have something that might count strokes around the glyphs. And, well, there is actually an ISO standard even for this. This ISO standard is something that covers everything that I have told you up to now. But what it doesn't cover are things like order indexes, registers of places, because in order indexes we have special links how names are sorted. You have all these, you have all this nobility stuff. So with fun and D and so on, and they're sometimes ignored when you make them in a register, and sometimes they're not ignored. Or you have things like location names, where you have saint in front, and sometimes the saint is taken, sometimes it's abbreviated to ST. And this really depends on your actual project. And I don't want to even start when you have to combine different scripts into the index. So if you have an order index, and you put now something, some name in it, transliterated, not doesn't matter actually, where suddenly letters appear that aren't there in the original alphabet. So you have something which is nominally called a half order and not a total order anymore, and one has to decide for a specific project what the order will be. There is no possibility that for these kind of special indexes something is done automatically. The project has to decide how do I want to do this now. And then we need a mean to write it up when we do it now. And this is, and I have to now to take care that I don't, what we advise are two steps, or two means of main means of configuration, how we enable you as the authors to configure Xindi to handle these kinds of special needs. The first step we call markup normalization. Markup normalization is the realization that quite often as an author, we need to put special hints to an index processor how we want to sort it. The thing that you might all be familiar with is if you sort something where you want a special representation in the index, and you just add the tag macro, the LaTeX tag, into your backslash index. So you, for example, want writing a book about tech, you want to index meta font, but you want to have this with this logo. So you index backslash MF. But it shall be sorted as meta font. So what you do normally is all the time when you have your index backslash MF, you add in front of it that in reality it's meta font. Well, that's quite bad, especially if you want to produce indexes automatically. What we do here now is, first of all, we gave a user the opportunity to say, even if it appears in the index this way, we actually mean that that's way. This is what we call markup normalization. So if it is there, there's a backslash MF in the input, we really mean meta font, please. Print it. It is backslash MF, by the way. So if in the final representation afterwards, it's back to the logo. Just the point how it is sorted and index afterwards. No need to have all these things. We produced a tech introductory book, and we had no of the special markups at all, even though we heavily used indexes for all kinds of tech indexing. The other thing that we do is that we know quite some of standard texts that are output by LaTeX. And those we don't know about, we simply ignore. So if you have something in the index that says backslash text bf or whatever else, well, it don't matter. We just ignore the text bf. You don't need it for sorting anymore. But if there's something in there that looks like an accent, then we know about it. And then we take it into account. And that's part of the basic configuration that we do around here. So after this markup normalization, we know what we want to sort. And then it comes to the point that we have to establish these characters and so on. And here we can say, I have a character, there's actually many characters long in the input, and I have to explain where it is sorted. And so we have a special notion for this cases, which is kind of low-level notion. He says, okay, we have something like here an L, and this is sort of like AE, or is an A after E. Yeah. And you can, in theory, write lots of these low-level declarations, sort rule, this is sorted like this, or this is sorted after this, or this is sorted before this, and so create your complete sort order this way. And you want adds a few of these clauses into cases when one has special characters in one index that doesn't appear in the normal basic language. But most of the time, when one creates a sort order for a new language, one doesn't want to go to the hassle and tell all these different rules. What we have here is a preprocessor where you establish classes of characters who are sorted similarly, and they just sort them, and this preprocessor produces these kind of rules afterwards. Well, that's about sorting multilingual. The other point is we said about encodings. Encodings means what's in the raw index file. One has to be careful. It actually doesn't mean what's in your tech file. It means what output by tech to the index file. This must be a big difference. It's not, for example, if you have Latin 1 classical tech and you use LaTeX and you say backslash index with a word with an A in it, an A in it. What's output is not the A. What's output is what's something which is called LaTeX internal character representation. Yes. And which is something completely different. So what appears now in the raw index file that we have to take and that we have to create things in is not ESO Latin 1 or Latin 9 or whatever else. What's happened to be there is LaTeX. Whereas other macro packages more or less let these characters through and you suddenly appear something like hat and two hex characters in it. Which is still not something that is recognizable as an egg afterwards. You still have to keep these, as you say, bit patterns that you find in the raw index file, and you have to look at them. And that's what we call encoding in this context. Not the encoding of the actual document, but the encoding of the stuff that is created by the ordering system in front of it. Which actually might not be tech alone, by the way. I have configurations for XML or HTML, where you have real good encodings afterwards. So if you happen to use a system where in this raw index file are UTF-8 characters, well, okay, just use it. There's a special command, an option when you call it, that says, this index file is encoded in UTF-8. And so, well, it just will just work. Because all other languages currently have a definition of UTF-8. As I have to say, we don't have a generic encoding model here that every language can appear in every encoding. That's also not practical in a pragmatic sense, because if you go beyond UTF-8 to traditional encodings, you typically have encoding that's a preferred one. So you have Cyrillic is most of the time in, what is it? ESO 8859, one of them, I think, A7 or 5 or something like this, yes. And so it doesn't make any sense to have the configuration for Cyrillic to be in Latin 1. So you're using Latin 5 there, of course. But UTF-8 is available everywhere here. And now we come to the point that, the end of the talk, where is it available? And we have something which is actually an announcement here quite now, but one wasn't able to upload it up to now. Because I made a new distribution in the last few weeks, and for the first time, Tindy is now available on Mac OS X and Windows as well. It still needs a local Perl installed, but I happen to have heard that this is not too much a bother. I'm actually thinking about, if this is just needed for some kind of driver scripts, I'm actually thinking about rewriting those driver scripts in Lua, since Lua will be available on TechLive and so on in the future. So this might be something which enables an easier installation in the tech ordering environment context. And For those who have happened to follow the last few years, we had lots and lots of problems by using a base system and creating some kind of plug-in for this base system. I simply got rid of this plug-in. I don't want to mention the adjective that I just was thinking about. Okay, so we have a website, of course. Every project has a website, don't it? And as I said, after the conference, it's there. Actually, 4 days afterwards, when I'm back at something which is these things, I will upload the new distribution of Helps. It will not be available, the new one, I think, in TechLive, because TechLive 2008 is too far in the production in process already. But we have the previous version in there, which runs on Linux and Unix. So those of you who happen to run Linux or Unix can use Cindy already, and those with Windows and Mac OS X systems have to download it. But in 2009, in the TechLive 2009, everybody will have it then over there. But yeah, documentation is available on the website, but I have to say, not in the really best shape. The best documentation available is actually in the LaTeX Companion 2nd edition, chapter 11. So you all buy the 2nd edition of LaTeX. So, and this is my last slide, so I won't keep you from... Oh no, that's not the copy. Ulrich is speaking after me.
You keep them from Ulrich, but not
from That's okay then. Yeah.
Just to mention what's currently on the slate. On the slate are two, I would say, two ways. One thing I really want to do and I'm likely to do, another which are room for improvements, where if other people come in and contribute ideas or even code, it's great, but where I don't know if I will happen to work there myself. What I want to do is, I want to support Unicode completely, not just UTF-8. Because quite frankly, what we currently do is that we use UTF-8 as an input encoding and convert it to some arbitrary rubbish which we use in between, and that's nonsense. What we want to do is to have a real Unicode, which means actually 32 bits of representation per character inside. The days where you have to code for some bytes for representation are over. Get over it. Tech is a lean engine by now. There was a time when Tech was large. Now Tech is something that's one of the smallest programs around. For example, I have currently a project where I'm producing 4 million pages from 1 million documents within 1 hour on one system. And it's blindingly fast, and it doesn't use any storage to talk about. And that's all the same here with indexing. I won't want to care to how if I have to use 2 bytes or 1 byte or maybe 3 or maybe 4 or even more bytes for the vector, doesn't matter. Just use, let's say, 4 bytes by now or 8 bytes in the future, and just use that. It's sufficient for that for anything. And what I want to have, I said that we have this preprocessor, which creates language stuff. I want to make this better integrated, and better in documentation would be great. But here I have even some people who started to help me, and that's I'm really glad of. Because as in so many projects, we are not many people who are actively developing, perhaps 3 or 4 currently. And so more people who use it and more people who try it are really appreciated. Well, guys, that's what I want to say. Thanks for your pages.